Hello, everyone, and welcome to today's webinar, Modeling Demand Elasticities for Consumer Goods and Retail Organizations, hosted by Thurgood Associates. By way of an introduction to the speakers on today's call, my name is Alistair Jones, and I'm a data analytics and BI consultant at Thurgood Associates based in the US. I'm also responsible for our commercial partnerships with vendors, including Microsoft and Databricks. I'm joined by my colleague, Deb Lee, who is also a consultant, a subject matter expert with respect to consumer goods, and a machine learning and MLOps practice lead. Our contact information is shown on the slide. Please feel free to reach out with any questions on the content we cover today. Our agenda for today's 30-minute webinar commences with an introduction to Thurgood, so you have more context than us. I'll then introduce and define demand elasticities. We'll share how data science and MLOps can help model demand elasticities. We'll apply that theory to a case study and show you a demo of modeling demand elasticities in action before wrapping up the session. So Deb and I are both consultants at Thurgood Associates, a specialist data and analytics consultancy operating globally with offices in the UK, US, Brazil, Singapore, and India. We offer a range of services from strategies and roadmaps to training and application support and maintenance, though the bulk of the work we do is application design and development, and that informs our ability to do everything else. We're a consultancy first and foremost, and to us that means we pride ourselves in our technical expertise, but we also focus on the business goals and problems we're tackling. We work with leading enterprise organizations and some longstanding clients listed on the screen. We have a great deal of experience serving enterprise scale consumer goods organizations over many years, including Unilever, JTI, and Mars. And we'll be drawing on some of that knowledge and experience during today's session. We're also independent, meaning that we collaborate and partner with an array of the key vendors in the data and AI space. We hold particularly close relationships with Microsoft, for whom we have 7 relevant gold competencies and are a managed partner, as well as Databricks. Deb, my colleague, actually presented at their flagship Data and AI Summit just a few weeks ago. Okay, so now let's explore demand elasticities a bit and understand what they are, why they're important, and how modeling elasticities effectively can benefit retail or a CPG organization. So let's start with a simple definition and a visual representation of the concept. So elasticity of demand is the responsiveness of the quantity demanded of a commodity to changes in one of the variables on which demand depends. Price is often the variable in question, but it's important to note that other variables can impact demand. And we'll highlight that during today's session. In essence, we're trying to determine the percentage change in quantity demanded for every percentage change in one of the variables. So why is it so important, especially today? Well, on your screen right now is a chart based on Nielsen data that shows the percentage change in sales between the same 3-week period in March 2020 versus March 2019 for certain goods. There's a massive spike in demand for household supplies. I'm sure a lot of us can remember that. But many other categories saw a market uptick too, like alcohol and personal care products. Conversely, consumer electronics saw a steep drop in demand. Suffice it to say, trends in retail and consumer goods demand have changed drastically since 2020, all over the world. In an unprecedented world, giving businesses the ability to understand what variables they can control and how changes in these variables will impact outcomes is critical. So how does the ability to effectively model demand elasticities for your goods help? Well, you can answer key questions like what products are most likely to increase in demand with a variable change such as distribution or promotion? Which categories are most susceptible to drop in demand if the economy isn't performing as well? Which brands benefit the most from increased marketing spend? How will changes in distribution on the shelf impact demand? What percent demand increase is anticipated for running a promotion over a given time frame for a certain product? Answers to all of these questions enable businesses to understand what variables they can control and what impact these variables have on demand for their products. So now let's tie the idea of demand elasticities in with data science and machine learning. So the concept of demand elasticities has been around for quite some time, but recent advances in data science techniques and tooling enables companies to more effectively, more rapidly, and more comprehensively model their demand elasticities. So organizations can now tap into a vast array of internal, third-party, and unstructured data that may reside in a data lake or other large data repository faster, accessing data more rapidly, the latest data, and also tapping into data at scale. There are now more powerful and fit-for-purpose open source packages available, such as FBProfit, which was used to build today's demo, as well as SKLearn and others. We have the ability to do scenario modeling thanks to real-time model deployments. Front ends, such as the one showcased in today's demo, are easy to stand up and iterate on thanks to offerings such as Microsoft's Power Apps. Finally, MLOps approaches allow investments in demand elasticity modeling to be more robust, reusable, and scalable than ever before. And a lot of organizations realize the potential of data science, ML, and AI to transform their business. An MIT Sloan BCG survey revealed that in 2020, 71% of organizations surveyed understand that AI changes the way their business generates value. Yet only 11% of those organizations reported significant financial benefits from the use of AI. Additionally, 66% of companies increased or did not change their AI investment since the onset of COVID-19, so it remains a priority. The rate of investment in the space is growing drastically, reaching over an estimated $110 billion by 2024. So why are people struggling? Why that kind of discrepancy between the 71% that understand its value, but only 11% reporting significant financial benefits? Well, it's inherently hard to scale machine learning models to incorporate other countries or channels. For example, as there may be nuanced differences in data, parallelizing models can also be difficult based on decisions that were made when the model was first developed or the models were first developed. It's useful but also challenging to have stronger governance and central oversight with respect to data science investments to avoid duplicating effort and in order to enforce standards that make applications simpler to maintain and enhance. Fundamentally, you need your end users, your business users, to trust your data science outputs. This obviously requires a degree of user education, but it also requires rigorous testing and incident and issue resolution with your models. Code, models, and datasets need to be resilient, reproducible, and auditable. Library versioning and security compatibility is important. Again, this isn't simple to achieve. Finally, models need to be accurate. Therefore, they need to be monitored. They need to be maintained and updated if and when that's required. With all that said, I'm now going to hand it over to my colleague, Deb Lee, who'll share more about how MLOps can help address some of these challenges on the screen. She'll also walk through a case study and a demo of demand elasticities in action. Over to you, Deb.
Thanks, Alistair. I am going to speak to first just a bit around the MLOps lifecycle itself, and then I'll get into some of the details and show some of the components that we've built in terms of our offering here. But typically when you're getting started on these types of engagements from an MLOps perspective, I think it's useful to sort of outline how we actually go about creating these types of systems and what you need to be thinking about even as you're getting started around getting a product itself into production and keeping it there and making it continuously useful for your end users. So you're going to start by defining your business problem, what are your business needs, and what are sort of the minimum requirements for an MVP or a POC from a data science perspective. So we want to perform what-if analysis by changing inputs to a model and understand what might happen. How are these changes going to impact my demand? Maybe I'm really interested in understanding how my innovation is performing. I want to detect potential opportunities in growing segments. So these are the types of questions where before you even start coding or building things from like an AutoML perspective, you want to make sure that you have a very clear sense of what you're looking to investigate and be able to define that. This will take you into the experimentation lifecycle. So you're going to be doing data engineering, feature engineering, that sort of cleansing, normalizing, imputation of missing values, creating lags, prototyping rapidly to get to end models that ultimately, by the end, after this sort of iterative cycle, you have a trained model that you're ready to take to production. Now that you have that model, how do you get it into production? So many times during the experimentation cycle, you're not going to necessarily be prioritizing or focused necessarily on components that will help your model run in production sort of at speed and at scale. So what does that mean? You might not be thinking about how to parallelize running thousands of models across different nodes in your cluster when you start experimenting, because you may only be really looking at a smaller subset of the data to prove out the value of that model initially. You might not be creating your full CI/CD pipelines either as you're experimenting, which makes sense. So there'll be some effort to productionize, add those components. Maybe you need a few more tests for your functions and classes. But then ultimately, what you'll do is you'll deploy those models, and then your end users can really start to use them and consume them. Great. What you need to keep in mind, though, is that ML systems are going to be dynamic, both from a data, a model, and an infrastructure perspective. And they're going to change as the world changes. So what we see a lot is, regardless of whether it's user data, you know, it's unstructured data, or it's data that's being collected by your business, every sort of type of data is going to be susceptible to types of drift. So changes from your baseline, maybe you change something in the manufacturing components that you have, and now that data set looks completely different from what it looked like when you were initially experimenting and training those models. You need to be able to go back and deploy enhancements to the models, fix things when they start to decay, and then also create a system where you can continuously integrate the feedback from your users back into it so that they keep using the product. This is the approach that we generally take for all of our data science and MLOps engagements, but I think it's pretty important to think about, you're not just trying to get something out the door, you're trying to make a product that's robust and sustainable over time as well. So now I'm actually going to talk about what we did for the demand elasticities. So our customer had some pretty well-defined key requirements that we needed to hit to be successful in this delivery and make sure that the end users were happy. So the first one was the ability to scale. So as I mentioned before, Alistair had mentioned this also, is we're not just trying to build something that only works for one brand or one product, right? We need a model that can sort of scale, and we can regularly retrain it, deploy many models potentially, and then keep our infrastructure costs as optimized as possible and not have pipelines that are necessarily running for hours and hours on end if they don't have to be. So we are using Azure Machine Learning's parallel run step functionality in this case for our model training, which allows us to effectively batch process many different models across the nodes on a cluster and actually keeps that infra low and optimized. The next key requirement was around explainability. So the results from our models needed to be able to be understood by the people that were using those models to make decisions. So really trying to understand here, which inputs for me, for my brand, my product, whatever, are the most actionable, and where should I really be focusing my energy, my promotional spend, my consumer promotion. So we've actually used FB Profit, which is a pretty well-known open source time series regression package that allows us to also extract the coefficients from the models, which are effectively going to be our elasticities in this scenario. So I can understand for this brand at this retailer, how sensitive is that brand to a change in getting another shelf on an item or another item on the shelf at that retailer? What will be the relative uptick in my demand if I change this? Which is my next point around scenario modeling. So the users really wanted to be able to actually simulate and play around with different inputs to see what would happen. So if I run a promotion for these 4 weeks within this time frame, and then I know that I, at the next upcoming shelf reset, I know I'm going to get 5 additional new items, I want to be able to capture all of those inputs and get a better view of my demand. Oh, and then also, I think the economy is going to tank next quarter, or I think it's really going to pick up next quarter, and I want to capture that input as well and see what it looks like. So we're actually using Power Apps for our front end with using APIs and real-time endpoints that are deployed from Azure ML, which gives us the ability to rapidly score and rescore to see a new scenario against our previously trained models. And then we've created visuals and Power Apps to actually let us see the trend and let us see the impact and not just get the numbers. And then accuracy. So I think this is a big one, or pretty common across a lot of data science initiatives, is that business users need to be able to trust the values that they're getting from, let's say a demand forecast. So even before we start that scenario modeling, we wanted to make sure that we were confident that the results that we were sharing back out, so our baseline forecast, was at least meeting or beating those existing demand forecasts that the users were already using. In terms of the technical architecture that I'm going to be showing you today, I'm not actually going to show every component. I think I'm just going to highlight some of sort of the most interesting ones. But the way that this all sort of hangs together is we have a blob data lake setup, and we're using Data Factory for data ingestion, data movement orchestration, data engineering being done in Data Factory. We have the model training and evaluation being done in Azure Machine Learning Services. We're using Kubernetes with Azure ML for that serving and deployment. For ongoing monitoring, we actually have the inbuilt functionality between Application Insights and Azure Machine Learning with the ability to export these M queries to Power BI for advanced monitoring reporting capabilities. And you can see the arrow going back here because oftentimes monitoring will sort of lead you back to the beginning of your life cycle. If you detect some issues, things need to be changed. And then we also have our Power App, which I will be showing next, which is really where the majority of the users were able to perform that modeling, the scenario modeling. Job orchestration, we have Data Factory and Azure Machine Learning, and then everything is sort of wrapped up in, from a CI/CD pipeline automation perspective within Azure DevOps in this case. So it's a full Microsoft end-to-end stack here. So what I'm showing here is actually a Power App. So this would be the first screen that an end user would go to actually start doing some of that scenario modeling that they're interested in. So most important, you need to make the selections. So they would go in, select what they're interested in. I will say that this, we've just gone for retailer brand level here, but this type of approach could be flexible. So if you were interested in looking at maybe individual promoted groups together or different groupings of custom items, or you wanted to look at it at just the channel level, that would all be possible. It's the same exact approach, just different slices of the data from a dimension perspective. And then if you look sort of along the second line here, we have, I had been already entering in some inputs, but this is where you're going to be able to see the elasticities. So the number that describes the relationship, both from a sign and a magnitude. So is it positive or is it negative? So as my input increases, does my output increase or decrease, right? And then the magnitude of it. So how large is that impact? So you can see here for this retailer brand combination, if you compare some of these elasticities, I have an input feature for average items per store selling here, and I have an input feature for the weekly economic index. So it's just an open source data set that captures, I mean, this is just for the US, but you could use something similar for other places. And then we also have a combined promotional metric here, which captures both your discount percentage and then the frequency of that discount. So these are all features that have been already experimented with and deemed to be important for this specific brand retailer model combination. So we actually have a different model for every possible combo that you could select on the screen. The reason being, sometimes you might not have any sensitivity to, let's say, the discount depth frequency or WEI. We know some retailers don't do as much from a promotional perspective, right? So this coefficient might not even have a value depending on what you select here. So we've already gotten to the point where we know what's important for these. So now we can start playing around with, okay, I can see that this brand seems to be quite sensitive in a positive way, meaning if I increase the discount depth frequency input feature, I would expect to see a uplift in my demand. And it's the least sensitive to changes in the number of items that I have on the shelf at that store for this brand. So down here, you can see this is where a user really gets to play around and enter in some inputs. So I'm going to say, you know, let's say for this next upcoming period, pick 12 weeks, you put in your discount percentage of one, maybe I'll make it two or something. Which weeks are the discounts applicable for? So if you know how many weeks you're going to run a promo for, does this brand have a cannibalization factor? And then what is the percentage increase of the economic index? Because its units are really already in the percentages. So I'm going to say the economy increases by 3% over that point in time. But really, you could put in anything. So then you're going to put in your inputs here. And the next screen that you're going to see here is actually giving you a lot of information, sort of taking into account those inputs that you just provided, which you can see here up on top. So the first thing on the left-hand side is really just giving me a sense of what, given this model, this brand, what does my demand forecast look like relative to the actuals if I back apply the values for that model across my historical data. So this is just always good to understand because you want to know how your forecast looks relative to your full history, right? So I can see actuals versus my predicted here, and it looks okay, right? And we know there were some rough periods over the course of 2020, so not surprising that maybe it's missing on a couple of those months. And then I can also see over here, what are my upper and my lower bounds for my prediction for those weeks that I had entered in, right? And then along the bottom, we've actually added some KPIs that are just useful, and especially for our users who are pretty interested in not just seeing, you know, what does the trend look like, but for that period that I specified, am I going to be making more money than I was last year? What's that growth percentage look like? Am I going to be losing share or growing share relative to sort of my baseline assumptions? So we can see here, based off of what I've entered, if we were to go ahead with this scenario or pick this scenario as our final one, I am projecting that I would be actually declining and losing a bit of share given what we know about this brand at this retailer. We've also created a couple of other screens where you can really zoom in on the actual forecast itself. What does the shape of it look like? So we can see my forecast here for those weeks that I had specified, and then the upper and lower bounds at a weekly level. We can also see the values from the chart, the up here, right? So if this is the sum demand, we can also get to what do the actual individual numbers look like, because people always want to be able to see the supporting data tables behind what they're working with. So this is actually the sort of the front end screen for the end users, but I'm going to flip and just show some of the other machine learning components as well. So the one thing that I will call out here is, as I'd mentioned before, we do have everything sort of packaged up from a code perspective in our repository within Azure DevOps. So you can see here under my elasticities folder, I am taking an infrastructure as code approach for my environment setups. So specifying what gets installed, using a Docker file image, and then a YAML file to install my various packages. Right. So in this case, I'm using FBProfit. And then you can also see, I'll show a snapshot of some of the actual pipelines that we've created to run this behind the scenes and create all those models. So this is sort of just our source code repository. And then I'm going to flip over and just give a view of Azure ML itself. So if you're not familiar with the Azure Machine Learning Studio interface, this is where you land when you just launch the studio. Basically, what we're doing here is you can see we are registering our data sets. So you can see I have my data set being registered. I can create automated alerts here, so that will let me know if my data changes beyond a certain threshold amount, so I don't have to constantly go in and check it. I'm doing experiment tracking here, so you can see from my training experiment, during that experimentation lifecycle, what are my key metrics on my models. I can see my pipelines. I can actually look and see the actual models themselves that I'm deploying. So for each retailer brand model in this scenario, I can go look at the previous versions. So there are 5 versions here and where they're being deployed. And then the final thing I wanted to show was actually the endpoints themselves. So the approach with the Power Apps and the real-time scoring is really possible because we're using a real-time endpoint here using Azure Kubernetes Services. So you can see I have a REST endpoint. So this is what I'm actually using with Power Apps to consume these models. Now I'm going to just wrap us up here with some next steps. Other things that we're working on. We're doing quite a bit at the intersection of the data science and CPG, manufacturing and retailing space. So consumer survey analytics, demand forecasting, SKU rationalization, sustainability, e-com, omni-channel, quite a bit. If any of these are interesting, definitely reach out. We're doing across sort of all of our customers, exploratory analytics, so really getting into that experimentation side, maybe uncovering unknown insights, providing MLOps and DevOps services, so really alongside that continuous integration and deployment, life cycle industrialization. So if you have a bunch of data science use cases and POCs, but you're struggling to get them into production, we can help. Analytics architectures. So many of our customers are interested to understand what do they need to do to enable a modern data architecture to support MLOps and data science at scale, data democratization to reduce bottlenecks to get data to everybody in the organization, analytics empowerment programs and rollouts, depending on the users or business functions, multi-cloud enablement. So this is becoming more and more of a hot topic that we're seeing. People really are interested to understand how they can get the maximum flexibility across cloud tooling and then strategies to succeed on analytics across the sort of people, data, tools, and processes needed there as well. And that is it. That's everything that we had for you today. So if any of this is interesting to you, please do not hesitate to reach out to me. So would love to talk about it. Thank you.